So I'm Cisco Fabli. I'm QA engineer for TDF. Been working in as a staff member for the last 3 years. And today, my presentation is called QA Quality Assurance 1 year recap. So we're gonna review what happened in the last year. For that, this presentation is divided into two main topics. The first one is about what happened in Vaxilla during this last year, and with some charts, some stats. And then the second part is gonna explain how the team is improving its automation of different ways of testing LibreOffice. First we start with the stats. And for that, that's something I've been doing already in other presentations. And for this presentation, I found interesting to compare what happened during this last year and the previous year. So for the data, I took information for 2018 from November 2017 until November 2018. And for this year, I did it from November last year, more or less when the last conference in Tirana took place in September last year, until the beginning of this month. When a bug gets reported, it goes, as you may know, to unconfirmed status. We try to keep the number of unconfirmed bugs as low as possible, because the lower the number is, the better is to, the faster we can interact or respond to new reports. So this is how, during this last year, the number of unconfirmed bugs has evolved. At some point, we reached 600, more than 600. And then the lowest was around 450. But this compared, so in average, it's 538. And compared to last year, we have increased the average of unconfirmed bugs. So basically, that means that, the trend is going up. So we should try to keep it down again and at least move it back to 400, around 400 or so, as we did last year. So that's basically something that we have to keep in mind. And then comparing the number of created bugs, in 2019, we had around 7,400, more than 7,400 bugs, which means 300 more than last year, which is around 5% more. And the number of triage bugs by the QA team, it's as we got more reports, we also did more triaging. So more or less, the number of triage bugs and created bugs matched for each year. So it means, or as I understand it, we keep doing the same amount of work. I forgot to say, but I'm showing here what's from my point of view, or from the QA point of view, seems to be interesting. But if you would like to know any other information, just let me know, and we can get that information and also show it in other presentations in the future. So this one is about regressions. So this year, as the chart shows, we are getting these are open regressions, so it's we are always getting more unresolved regressions. So in average in 2019 we have around 1,000, and in last year it was around 883. So I would say that in average the number of open regressions increased by 100 every year. And then this year 1,200 bugs were identified as regressions, which is 100 more than last year. And for those bugs identified as regression this year, 384 are still open, which is higher than last year, but it's kind of expected because some of them were recently discovered. So, they are still unresolved, but because we didn't have time yet to solve them. On the one hand, we have regressions, but sometimes it's difficult to know when that regression was introduced, especially in the beginning of the project. We didn't have bisected repositories, so it was difficult to identify the commit introducing the regressions. So this chart, to me, seems more significant because we use the keyword bisected when the commit introduction the regression was identified. So sometimes it might be easier to fix that regression. I say sometimes because sometimes it's not. But at least we have a starting point from where we can start to work on this regression. So, the chart shows the same trend. We are going up, but the difference between the beginning of the year or the beginning of the period for 2019 and the beginning of this month is not that different. So it's just 80. We have 80 more from the beginning up to now. And yeah, the number of identified bisected regressions in both years are more or less the same, and still open 265. So as said before, some of them were recently identified. So still, we didn't have time to fix them yet. This chart is quite interesting. Because we have high guessability bugs. It's going down. So we had 2 points in the chart where the number of high guess priority bugs will drop. And that's mainly because at that point, the QA team decided to review those bugs. And we found out that they were inherited from OpenOffice times. So it's been 9 years from now. And it doesn't make sense to have those being high severity bugs for such a long time. So after 9 years, it means it's not that high the severity as it used to be. So right now we are at 25 high severity bugs. Ideally, we should be around zero. We get new ones every week, but then they get fixed. Most of them, they get fixed quite fast because they are mentioned in the EAC meeting, and So at least I'm happy to see this chart going the trend going down. Hopefully by next year it should be around 10. And as we can see, comparing 2019 and 2018, this year half of them were fixed compared to last year, and basically that's because the reason why we have less high guessability bugs fixed this year is because in the past we used to have more bugs, so any crash, even like really hidden crust was identified as highest. And when we have slightly changed this policy, and now we are more strict about which bugs are really highest or not. So that's the reason why in 2018 we had more highest severity bugs fixed compared to this year. But on the other hand, if we look at the high priority bugs, which is one level below, so they are, well, should be fixed soon, but not the priority is not as important as highest. We see that this year, compared to last year, we have got around 30 fixed more than last year, and yeah, the trend is also going down. But it's important to mention that we are still at 475. So first, we probably from the QA team, we need to, well, review them, recheck them, reevaluate them to see if they are really high severity bugs, and well, from the if they really are, then well, all together with developers should try to get this chart at a lower number, because well, 475 is quite a high number. And other interesting fixes this year, we fixed around 241 crashes this year, which is 50 more than last year. It's also interesting to see that we got many performance issues fixed as well. Almost the double compared to last year. So yeah, there were many performance issues fixed in Calc and also in Writer. And then it's interesting to see that we are still fixing all bugs. Well, when I say all bugs, I mean bugs that were reported more than 4 years ago. So in 2018, we got much more than compared to this year, but we are still there and we are still fixing them. So that's important, at least to me, because it means that, well, at least those bugs don't get forget in Bugzilla. And then for those bugs that were closed this year, this year we have 6,852 bugs fixed. Well, when I say fixed, I mean resolved. So 34 of them were resolved as resolved fixed, 18% as work for me, insufficient data, 11% not a bug, 6% duplicates, 22. One fix, 4.3, and then others that were below 2% go around 5%. So now we have every month we have a block in the QA, a post in the QA blog where we have this information for every month and even more detailed information about what happened that during the month in QA and development. So if you're interested, just check the blog. And then about the second part of the presentation, it's going to be about automation. So first, some of you may know that we use a script to check interoperability. We started to use it 2 years and a half ago. We are still using it. We have it in a VM, and we use it with many around 2,000 Writer documents and around 1,000 Calc documents. Impress documents. So basically, what we do is to open it to create a PDF, and then we open the same document in Microsoft Office, and then we compare the documents, the PDF outputs, to see if there are differences. So this way we can see if there are regressions in master. So this year, we found 34 regressions, interoperability regressions, still open 10, but as I said, some of them were recently introduced or found, and then we already have 20 fixed. So it means that, almost two-thirds of the issues found during the year are already fixed. And here we have some of examples of the findings from these scripts. So basically, here on the left, we have the result from Word, and there on the right, the result from Writer. So as we can see, some paragraphs are going left to right, and then others right to left. So all of them should be aligned to the left. So yeah, that was. I'm going to do it quick. So this is an example that was fixed and found by the script. This is another one which is not fixed yet, but as you can see, some of the labels on top and here some of the bottom are gone. So these are the kind of issues that this script finds. Then regarding UI testing, we have this year 170 related commits. RAL did a lot of work in this area. We had a Google Summer of Code doing an interpreter of the for the UI testing. And right now we have 500 UI tests in total. Most of them Calc and Writer, and it's interesting to say that we don't have any for draw. So if RAL, you're here, you want to do it, yeah, it's an invitation. And then there's something I've been working this year. It's called, well, mass UI testing, because we use the UI test framework to with a pool of documents. Basically the code is there in that URL. So basically what we do is to run a script and we say, I want this directory where all my documents are. And then, I use this instance of LibreOffice. And this here component, I just say if I want Writer or Calc or Impress. So basically what it does is iterates over a list of files that I have in that folder. Then it creates a random user profile for each folder, and then it copy-pastes a registry modification with some parameters, like I want the macro execution disabled, ignore protected areas, and other parameters. And then I have another file, which is a Python file, and where I define the kind of test I want to test with those documents. So then every method starting with test underscore will be a different test. And then what we do is to parse the output from the UI test framework and see if the test pass or not, or we have a timeout of 20 seconds. And then, it's this I forgot to say, this script is mainly used for finding crashes. So mainly tested in Writer and Calc, and I still need to do it multi-threading. So I talked with Colin and Marcus, and I would like to test it with the pool of documents we use for the crash testing, and run it in the VM. But so far, these are the kind of tests that it can test that it uses. So basically, I open the document. It opens the document, remove all the contents, and then undo, insert new line, undo, page break. They are simple tests, but when testing against many documents, some documents might crash. So this is kind of Yeah, this is a basic sample of a test. So basically, it executes the command select all, then delete, and then executes the command undo, and then, well, close the document. So here's an example of a crash found. I wanted to show you, but I think I'm running out of time already. So yeah, so right now I'm testing, and I use it with 2,600 files in Writer with these formats, ODT, docx, docrtf, and there were many crashes found related to the fly at charge selections, which are inherited from OpenOffice, and recently MicroStyle fixed them. They are backported to 6.3, so all these crashes I then retested, and they are all, well, there's still, no, I think there's just one that seems related, but there were like 35 or 40 files crashing, and now all of them are fixed, so that's really good news. And then the same for calc. Well, these are some of the tests that I've implemented, I'm just using. So inserting rows, columns, we do it for every sheet. Then high column, high row, print preview. And then this is an example of a text, of a test. So we open the file, then we go to the first sheet, and then we iterate over all of them, and for each one we insert a row below, then we undo it, and then we go to the next sheet. This is a crash that is still reproducible, and it was found by this script. And well, in calc I use 560 files with those extensions, and it was useful to find crashes when Noel did the dynamic number of columns work. So yeah, and all of them were fixed right away. So yeah, in that sense, it was really useful. And yeah, that's it. Thank you. Yeah. Sorry for the rush.